Everyone, it's good to be back. It was, of course, we were back last week. I'm just excited about tonight to get to share with you. Want us to go back to what we had been, what you have been looking at, really from before we left to last week. Anyway, it's good to see Michonne. She looks bright and like she's got some energy tonight. Are you okay? Oh, you'll make a good lawyer, Kelso. You can make statements say something they don't say, or a good political operative. Philip is home. He's struggling with his foot, so need to pray for him. Mark is going to go to Mexico this weekend to do BTCP there, and so we need to pray for him. Who's traveling with you? Okay, Molly is going to be interpreting for you. Hey, Eric, how are you? Hope you've been doing your homework, and I hope you're keeping up with it. And I just want to remind you, we do these things so we will know how to approach the scriptures, and so that we would know the scriptures, and so that we would know God. It is not so we can say, oh, yeah, I know how to do that, or I know the techniques, and I know that. I mean, those are just tools. Carpenter doesn't just, well, some carpenter, I guess carpenters do. You know, you can brag about your tools, but it's the finished product is what matters. Sometimes in the work that we do or in the lives that we live, we can't even display those things for everyone to see. If you're a plumber, what do? Display the sink or what's underneath the foundation of the house. But you don't think about it so long as the plumbing is working. And it's the same thing in the Christian life. It is not for the display of our glory that we learn these things, but it's for the display of the glory of God. So let's just always keep that in mind. How is your family, Ken?
Doing well, better.
Okay, good. Marcus Aurelius, would you lead us in prayer? Just thank the Lord for our time and ask for His grace.
Lord, thank you for another day. Thank you for loving us and allowing us to get together and study your word. Lord, I pray that you would bless us with understanding and with knowledge of you and with the wisdom to use what we learn. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Okay. Think through all of the books of the Bible that we've studied so far, and I just want us to review it. And the thing that I want us to do is to connect the theological dots. So all of the details, and we already went through that, and you were given some very important information the last few weeks about structure, dates, times, peoples, and all of that, who wrote them, how they were preserved, and what are the themes of those books. But I want us to be able to see it, step back even further back from each one of those books, and then let's see from where we are today, let's see how we can see the big picture, base, so to speak. Yes, but I want us to connect the theological dots on it. Okay, so let's begin with the book of Genesis. Book of Genesis is about what? What? Beginnings. And who? What? Tell me things you know about the book of Genesis.
Creation.
Okay. Creation. Fall.
I'll use the theological term that we use. You remember what that word means?
Proto
is first, and then Evangelio, good news. The first mention of the good news. Okay. What else? Who are the main characters in the book of Genesis? That's an easy way for us structurally to be able to see it. There are two ways to look at structure of the book of Genesis. You can look at it in the way it's written, like these are the generations of. You can follow that structure, or you can simply follow the people involved. Like, for instance, Genesis 1 through 1 and 2 is what?
Adam.
Oh, it's what? God. And what about God in 1 and 2?
Creation.
Okay, so 1 and 2 is creation. And then 3. And then 4 is what? The generations of
Adam.
Okay. Actually, it's who is the main character that's mentioned in 4? This is an easy way to remember this. Whose family? What? Which person? Which person?
Cain.
Thank you. And then 5. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you.
I like that hand motion.
So now we have this. Yeah.
We just put Adam. And then 6 through 9. Okay, Noah. And then 10 and 11. Okay. I'm writing this more like this so you can see it, because it is the foundation for the rest of what we're going to see. And then 12 through 50.
Abraham.
Isaac, Jacob, Joseph.
Somebody have a festival. Okay. That's pretty much the book of Genesis. That's how you will see it. Now I want you to notice that in creation 1 and 2, this is, the one is
this, the first one is cosmic and universal, meaning all of creation. And then the second part of it is about man, and what, and I'll use again the theological word we use. Okay. And I want to explain that in a little bit. Okay, how about Exodus? What is Exodus?
Okay. What is the main point of Exodus? This is now, so this is a family, and this is now who?
Nation.
Nation.
I got up to leave, nobody laughed at me.
Don't laugh at
me. It's all right, I'll take it.
And what did they do as a nation? Thank you. Or, as Bruce Wilkinson would say, they exited Egypt.
Exodus.
He said, when you want to remember a word,
go with Exodus is the word exit. That's actually what he used. By the way, he's, as far as I know, he's the only one that did his dissertation at Dallas Theological Seminary that was not written. He did his Old Testament, a walk through the Old Testament. And it's fascinating, really. How many of you have ever been to walk through the Old Testament? You have? Okay. How many of you have been through the walk through the New Testament? You have? That's great. So they left Egypt. And what is the significance that we find in 19 through 23?
Okay, the law. Is that just the law? What would you call it?
Covenant.
Covenant, thank you. What is that covenant?
By the way, in 12, what do we find in 12? Okay. singular. Okay. Leviticus. What's Leviticus?
Thank you. And
how does it
do?
How we relate to God, and then the second half is how we relate to one
another. How about Numbers?
Lots of numbers in numbers.
Wanderings. Okay. This is their wanderings or journeys from. Where did they go? What positions, geographical positions, did they travel from? From what place to what place? They already left Egypt.
From Mount Sinai.
From Mount Sinai to Egypt, or to the border of.
A key thing, and I will put it here because it's important, and it's the way to look at numbers to remember it is how many senses were there. Two. What is the significance of the two senses? Sis.
Okay. And the second generation. After.
The second generation. Okay. So they were counting the military people,
the ones who were serving. Okay. And so that's a good way to look at that. And in between those two censuses are 23 and 24. Chapters 23 and 24. What do you find in chapters 23 and 24?
A talking donkey. It's a good way to remember that too. And keep in mind also the scenario
of that. The nation of Israel as a people were totally oblivious to what was going on the mountains overlooking the plains where they were camped. They did not know. And one thing to, and that's something that we will see here in a minute. I just want to write it down here. So, the oracles of Balaam. And then Deuteronomy.
Second giving of the law.
The word nomos
is the word for law, and then, of course, the second giving of the law. Okay. What is Deuteronomy about?
These words.
Okay. So it was a review of what God had already done. Why was it necessary to review what He's already done in chapter 20 through 23 of Exodus?
They didn't know God's law.
New generation.
They needed to be reminded again. And by the way, structurally, it's
an easy book to look at also because these are sermons that Moses preached, whatever his name is, Moshe. That's his Hebrew name, Moshe. That's Moshe Dayan. His name is Moses, Moshe. I was telling them earlier, I said, you know, there are those Hebrew names and names in the Bible, you can get tongue-tied with them. You know, of course, I love to say Mahershalal Hashbash, the longest name in the Bible, who's the second son of Isaiah, but their name. However, the important thing about those names is please don't insist that, okay, it's mentioned like, okay, this name, Caleb, probably how it's spelled. I made a mistake of doing a devotional at the nursing home one time, dressed up with full gear, introduced myself as Caleb. They had no clue what I was talking about. We want to communicate the truth of God's word. We don't want to just insist of, you know, okay, this is the right pronunciation. It doesn't matter if we communicate the truth to them. That is what's important. No, I didn't wear my Muslim hat. I have Muslim hat. So, okay, the second giving of the law, and then Joshua.
The what? Okay.
Okay. Let's use the word that they use because it's a military thing, conquest of Canaan. Judges.
They were in rebellion.
Okay. By the way, that
gives you a cue also on a clue on probably the author of the book of Judges, because something that is common that is stated in the book is in those days Israel had no king. So it's probably written by someone during the period of monarchy. In those days Israel had no king. So there was a rebellion, no king. Everyone did okay, and then Ruth. Let's just put Ruth here since it's under the period of the judges. What's Ruth about?
Like yesterday, Ryan told me, excuse me, I kept calling Bridget.
Brittany.
And then when I said, okay.
I said, okay, I'm going to introduce Bridget. And he goes, you mean Brittany? I said, what? Okay, what about Ruth? Horrible time. And of course, the first verse of chapter 1 lets us know that God will accomplish his purpose in the days when the judges ruled. So this is still this mess here. But there, God will have his people, some of his people, who will the remnant, who will walk with him. And it's not just for the Jews, but also for the Gentiles available to them. And then we'll look at 1 and 2 Samuel tonight. But I want us to look at that. If you're looking at, I know we go the overall picture, the meta-narrative of the Bible. In the Old Testament, when you look at the theological center, the fulcrum on which all of the Old Testament focuses on, one of the things that you will look at, there are two possibilities. One is Exodus 19. Turn your Bibles to Exodus 19. In Exodus 19, I guess I need my Bible. Someone read verses 3 and 4.
And Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, this is what you are to say to the house of Jacob and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to the Lord.
Okay, no.
Now, I want you to understand something. I want you to see something here. Notice that the deliverance of the people of God from Egypt was accomplished by whom?
By God.
Because he said, I've freed you from bondage, I've carried you on eagle's wings. So their redemption was something that God wrought, that he did himself. Okay? The covenant, the Mosaic covenant, was not that. This is a preface to that. He's already done that. He's already freed his people from Egypt. 400 years of slavery, 430 years total that they were in Egypt, and God prophesied about that. Or not prophesied. He told Abraham that in Genesis 15, that your people will be enslaved in a foreign land for 400 years because the sins of the Amorites have not reached their full measure. Okay? Just file some of those notes in the back of your head because they're all important. But I want you to see, as we have seen before, that the Bible is really the story of God and His redemption, His work of redemption. And then what we see here, someone read verses 5 and 6.
Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you are to speak to the Israelites.
Okay, so he's already freed them from bondage. He said, I've freed you from bondage. I have carried you on eagle's wings. Now, if you obey fully, what is that phrase, that statement? Is that a condition to what he's about to do with him?
Okay, so
there's a condition of obedience on their part. If you are going to obey fully everything I'm about to tell you, the laws and decrees I'm about to give to you, what will happen?
You will be
my treasured possession.
A kingdom of priests.
A holy nation. So them being able to function in the way that God intended for them to function as a nation, you will be my treasured possession. You will be a kingdom of priests, which means what? Kingdom of priests. Priests, what did the priest?
They mediated
people to God and God to the people. Okay? So the object has always, or the goal has never been just for the nation of Israel. They've already been freed from bondage. So why does God need a nation of priests?
To mediate
to the rest of the world who God is. Okay, so keep that in mind. And the ability of the nation of Israel to fulfill their function as a nation, which is a kingdom of priests, his possession, and as a holy nation, is what? What is the condition? Obedience. They have to obey. And I know Scott talked about there are two kinds of covenants. You remember what the two kinds of covenants are?
Conditional covenant
and
additional covenant.
Covenant. The Abrahamic covenant . What kind of a covenant is it? Okay? This is unconditional. And what is the promise of the Abrahamic covenant? Three things in Genesis 12 verses 1 through 3. The what?
Okay. Three things.
Three things that he promised. Look at the text.
All 1 through 3.
I will bless those who bless.
Okay, blessing.
I will curse those who curse.
Seed and land.
Okay. And then here in the Mosaic covenant. This is unconditional, and this is conditional. And what is the promise here that's conditioned upon their obedience?
That they will be a mediator to the nation.
Okay, kingdom of priests.
So these things will only happen, their function as a nation can only happen according to their obedience to the Mosaic law. Okay? And we will get into the thing here. But, so if we say that the fulcrum or the purpose or all of the theology of the Old Testament is based on this, really it looks more just functional than anything. But we need to look further back. And I know our Kenya group, they're probably tired, and some of you probably are tired of me going back to Genesis, but you really can't understand. Keep in mind, too, The book of Genesis is the foundation book. It's a foundational book, not only for the books of Moses, the five books of Moses, but also for the rest of the scriptures. Only as you understand here, only as you understand the book of Genesis, will you be able to make sense of really from Exodus all the way to the New Testament. It's hard to make it. You cannot make sense of it. And what the things that are mentioned here in terms of law, the things that have been codified in terms of ethics and morals and relationships, Exodus, and the rest of the books, Deuteronomy, right before they walked into the Promised Land, these were all hinted here through narratives, through stories. Before God says, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, in the rest of the books of Moses, how do we know that's already in the heart of God here? The story of Abraham, okay, and Sarah, they went to Egypt, and with Abimelech, and who else? Isaac had the same thing, Rebekah and Abimelech, okay? So we know that is there, and so when they heard that it's been codified, this is now part of the law, it was not anything new to them. They knew the story. They knew the story. But even further back than that, how did God create man? In his image, and how did he create man? In his image, in his own likeness.
Male and female.
For this reason, 2:24, for this reason, a man will leave his father and his mother and shall, what? Cleave, means to be glued unto. Cleave unto his wife. I have some wash rags in my office. Oh, that's terrible. Anyway, those of you watching, it's a private joke, shouldn't have said it, but anyway, turn back to Genesis, because personally I believe that the focus, the fulcrum on which the rest of the theology of the Old Testament is—it's really this is the one, and it's something that I quote a lot because I believe it's the most important theological point in all of the Old Testament and New Testament. It's what defines for us the rest of how we understand the Old Testament. Which is, someone read 26 through 28, chapter 1.
Yes. Genesis 1:26-28.
And God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created man in his own image, in the image of God he created him, male and female he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and every living creature that moves on the ground.
Okay. Man is the highlight. It's the man is the supreme creation. All of the other creations are for the purpose of being of their relationship to man, and how man relates to God. And that's where you find really all of the understanding, including the messes that we have created from the beginning of time, from Genesis 3 on. And there are two words, I mean several words that are important, but two words about the function of man here are the words, where's my black one? Lost it. Where? Oh. And that is the word rule and subdue. they're from the same root word in the Hebrew. But before we understand this, we need to understand how man was created. In most of our, in all of our translations, it says in beginning 26, let us create man, how?
In our
image, in our likeness. I want to tell you, the you can have, and this you can find this in some alternate readings, and scholarship has proven that you can translate it this way. Instead of in our image, you can translate it as our image. So man was created not just a reflection, but as the very image of God, the God who cannot be seen. This is seen in man. Does that language remind you of a passage in the New Testament? The what? He is the image of the invisible. Colossians 1:15, which we camped on for a long time. Christ is the image of the invisible God. Christ is the second Adam. Christ fulfilled what the first Adam and the rest of humanity failed in. Okay? And so man, as the image of God, the primary function of his of man being the image of God is these two. And it means that to rule, to have does this definition remind you of a text in Genesis 3? Yes. Yeah. Yeah, Genesis 3:15. This is what defines really the rest of the theology of the Old Testament. This is how we understand the rest of it, and I'll keep going on so we can get even the hopefully a clearer and the larger picture that oversees or is over all of the theology of the Old Testament. Any questions so far? I want to make sure that we're just, y'all have that look like, yeah.
It struck me when you talked about, you know, in our image being translated as our image, it implies, which I mean we always know, but when you translate it that way, it seems that the creation of man had a greater purpose at that point beyond just, you know, look what I did.
Yeah.
All of the study that was done in, especially in 2 Peter, but, you know, back in main service, last year when you were going through Peter's writings, that's the first thing that this connected me to. It made me think, because there was so much emphasis on who you are.
Okay.
Well, and Paul too. There's a lot of time in the New Testament spent on that.
And the New Testament really is expounding for us what has already been said in the Old Testament. I just want to make sure that we're connecting those dots, because all the laws, all of those, and how they disobey them or obey them, the monarchy, all of that can only make sense as we understand what God's purpose from the beginning has been, was, and is, and why he would even send his son. What is the purpose of that? And I know in American theology, we'll just say, well, because he just loves us. I mean, that's true. God loves us. But there's a theological, biblical purpose for that, because God had a purpose for his creation of man, which man messed up in Genesis chapter 3. And God is unwilling to let his image, his monument, his living monument to be left in rubbles, crumbling. And that's why he sent Christ to be the second Adam, to fulfill what man could not fulfill. And so our understanding of the rest of the Old Testament must be anchored on that understanding of God's purpose for the creation of man. In fact, one of you has Psalm 8. Would you read? Now, you all can turn to Psalm 8, but I want you to see Psalm 8. And this is the Psalm of creation. Who has Psalm 8? Okay, would you read that?
Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the heavens. You have set your glory in the heavens. To the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them, human beings that you care for them? You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet. All flocks and herds and the animals of the wild, the birds in the sky and the fish in the sea, all that swim the paths of the sea. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Okay. Notice the language that is used here. By the way, in verse
5, how many of you have NIV translations? Okay. Is there an alternate reading to heavenly beings or angels in verse 5.
Christian says you made them a little less than God.
Okay.
Okay. That is really a better translation of that. So man was created a little lower than God. And he has been given the task of being God's to rule, to subdue. God is the sovereign God. He wants man in his creation to be his co-regent or his, I will put a hyphen here. Normally the word does not have a hyphen, but just to show you the we normally would say viceroy, but it's from the word vice, which means like an assistant, someone under someone. And the word roy is the same word as rex, as ray, which means king. He's the assistant king. Man was created to be God's assistant king to rule over. When it says you shall have dominion over what? The birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and the beasts of the field. And here in chapter 8, in Psalm 8, it says, notice also verse 6, you made him what? Ruler, same word, over the works of your hands and put everything under their feet. Man was supposed to have dominion over everything. And then it discusses all of that. Let's see. Any questions? Yes, sir. That's a good question. Probably in function, more functionality. I know man is the only one that has been given in all of creation the ability to make choices, to have the kind of mind that he has given us, and to have a heart that can respond to him. And that is why in Genesis 2:7, when the recounting of how man was created, where he took some dust of the earth, and he formed man, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath, plural, of life, gave him ability to function, to be animated, so to speak, but also the ability to, not the ability, but also gave him his spirit so that then he can have fellowship with God. So it's in that sense. It's not like in terms of, I don't think it's in terms of qualitative thing, but it's more probably terms of functionality. And above, compared to all of creation, man is the highest being. And I've said this before. Have you ever wondered why angels cannot be redeemed? Why animals cannot be redeemed? why plants cannot be redeemed. I'm so glad that animals cannot be redeemed. Won't have to deal with cats in heaven. Of course, Mark Emmons asked me one time, he said, I thought you said we're going to have good food in heaven. I better stop there since we're online. So I think it's in terms of that functionality, and it's a wonderful function that we have. We are his co-regents on this earth. And in Genesis 2, when it says, and he had him name all of the animals, that is in Eastern culture, to name another being, another person, or things is to show dominion and power. And man was given that position, that function, to do that, to name all the animals. So you see that. I want you to see, who has Isaiah chapter 11, verses 6 through 9? Laura?
The wolf will live with the lamb, the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. Is this right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it is. The cow will feed with the bear, their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord, and the waters covered as the waters cover the sea.
Okay, what does it say about
a young child? What will he do?
And what else? He'll play near the cobra.
Well, before that,
we'll lead them.
We'll lead them. The word for lead, the Hebrew word for lead, has the idea of headship or rule, rulership. And that is a prophetic, what we call an eschatological segment. Eschaton means future. Eschatological vision that God gave him, that when man is restored to his rightful place, a child will have that kind of dominion over the animal kingdom. And that is why animals that are can be very aggressive, he will have dominion. He will exercise dominion. A child will exercise dominion. Can you imagine Liam as a child in the millennial kingdom? Having dominion. I know he's already trying to exercise his dominion over everyone. But that's really a restoration of that which was lost in Genesis 3. Who has Hosea 2:18? Go ahead. Come.
In that day I will make a covenant for them with the beasts of the field and the birds of the air and the creatures that move along the ground. Bow and sword and battle I will abolish from the land so that all may lie down in safety.
Okay. Why will that happen?
Notice again the language that is used. That is reminiscent of what passages in Genesis that we just read. Over the birds of the air, and basically all of the animal kingdom. It's the same thing. It is at that time I will make a covenant, which means I will restore that which was lost. Okay, I want to give you a couple of instances in the New Testament that hopefully gives you also a good perspective on this, about man having dominion and rule and headship over creation, over the rest of creation. Who has Matthew 8:23-27?
The boats followed him. Without a warning, a furious storm came up on the lake, so that the waves swept over the boat. But Jesus was sleeping. The disciples went and woke him, saying, Lord, save us. We're going to drown. And he replied, you have little faith. Why are you so afraid? Then he got up and rebuked the winds and the waves, and it was completely calm.
Okay.
Mark's and Luke's account of this, and this account, keep in mind, Jesus is the second Adam. And yes, the text is not explicit. He could have done it because he was God, and he could have ordered that. But I want you to consider the possibility that he was exercising his authority.
That's the second Adam who has dominion over creation.
Creation. In fact, who has Matthew 14, 22 and 23?
This is Jesus walks on the water. Immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It's a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?"
Okay.
In Matthew 8, Christ spoke to the wind and to the elements, and they obeyed him. Here, he doesn't say anything. Matthew 14, he doesn't say anything. What does he simply do? He just walked on the water. He simply walked on it. If this is simply the act of a divine act on his part, I think it would have been blasphemous on the part of Peter to have participated in something that only belonged to God. But because he was the second Adam who has been charged with, as who's been given the purpose of, as the image of God. He is the image, and in the Colossians 1:15 does say that he is the image of the invisible God, which is the intent of Genesis 1:26. That has always been the intent. Let us make them as our image, as our likeness, exercising dominion over all of creation. Which, when you look at the rest of the scriptures, like the last chapter of the book of Mark, which crazy people today say, "Oh, you're handling snakes," and then they get bit and they die. But in the eschaton, you can handle snakes.
Yes, thank you.
So if Adam had never sinned, he would be walking on water and in storms.
Because he has been given dominion. Man has been given dominion.
That's always been taught, as he did those things because he was God.
That is why I want us to see the scriptures for the way God intends us to see it, which is from his
perspective, through the lens of who God is and how he's created man and all of the rest of creation. Y'all are quiet.
The Turksville region, Viceroy, when you represent the king, and you're somewhere else, you know, and you're not, the king's not there, you're somewhere else. When you speak, the words you use are the king's words. And that's what's why it's so important when you represent the king that you say the right things, because everyone assumes that when you speak, the words that come out of your mouth are the words of the king. And so those terms say the same thing for us, that we have that we would have that authority, that we would have that dominion, and that the words we say are are the same. So, you know, God commands the storm. We have the same ability to, I mean, to command the storm. Obviously, we're a little lower. But I mean, your words are the same. And so, I'm desperately trying not to pull out this term, you know, the ideas there. But I mean, that's really what those people did. Anyone that spoke for the king who was ever in authority was expected to represent what the king had to say. And so that term, like you know, when we say a preacher or a herald, that's why the pastor's job when you preach is so important, because you are speaking the words of God, and so you have that responsibility.
In practical applications, I want you to consider this.
Too often, in both in ministry, in counseling, dealing with people over the years, one of the issues that we have faced, and we probably an issue that we all struggle with, is that sense of insecurity about who we are. One of the things I do when I do counseling is I take them back to understand how God created man. What is the purpose for man? When we were in Kenya, we were not just telling them, says, you know, husbands, love your wives in the same way that Christ loved the church, in the same way you love your own bodies. Wives, submit to your husbands, respect them, give them the proper respect. I mean, we said those things, but from the perspective, we started the teaching from the perspective, this is how God created you, men, and this is how God created husband and wife. And this is how it's going to end, with a wedding of Christ with his church to live happily ever after, in the new Jerusalem, in the new heaven, in the new earth. Beginning and end, all of life is bookended by marriage, by his purpose, the nobility and the majesty of that purpose of God for men. So when people say, oh, you know, I'm just not any good, you know, I grew up in this home. And if you know Christ, this is something that should send you going, yeah. Yes. And that is why you hear me a lot. We are not defined by our circumstances nor by our emotions, but we are defined by who Christ is and who we are in Christ. I mean, we're sorry a lot, even as Christians, because we too often go, well, you know, I just feel bad today and something bad happened. You have a good God who created you for a noble purpose. And that bad thing that happened did not nullify God's purpose in you. Did not nullify what Christ is going to finish in you, in his redemptive work in you. And so we should trust him for that. By the way, I'm looking at the clock, so because we still have to do 1 and 2 Samuel. But I wanted to do this. I want to be able to connect for y'all, because I know you have all this information about dates, structures, and all of that. I want us to see the beauty of that theology of the Old Testament and all of the scriptures. No. But think about this. We just read in Matthew 14, Jesus just walked on the water. How does creation begin in Genesis 1? There was the tohu and the bohu, this chaos and the watery mess. And what does it say? And the Spirit of God hovered over it, fluttered over that.
It's like you just took everything from the
tree. Well, that's what the scripture does for us. I mean, God, it's always been there. But what we have done too often is we take bits and pieces of it. And that's why I'm always saying, read the whole book. Read all the books. Read them in continuity. Listen to them. So you can kind of get a sense of the connection of all of them. And in creation, how did God bring about creation?
He spoke.
Okay. Okay, you go. Okay. I know where you're going with this. Yes. That's why it's important to pay attention to the Word of God. He spoke, creation came into being. He spoke and he created things out of what we call ex nihilo, out of nothing. It is by the power of his word that he created everything. It's by the power of his word that he sustains everything in all of creation. So it is by his word that he proclaimed that there's going to be the seed of the woman and what he would do. And it was by his word that he made the promise and he made the covenant with Abraham, an unconditional covenant. It is his word that he preserved for them here. And all through this. And in Deuteronomy 4 and 5, in 4 it says, the people said to Moses, now we know that a people can hear the voice of God and not die. And in chapter 5, they appealed to him. It says, you go and talk to God. And that's why even last Sunday, yesterday, I said, the word of God is a matter of life and death. It is not simply that we're expounding an academic thing. Yes, it's an academic thing, but it has to do with life and death of people. This is not, okay, we got so many people baptized, we have so many people. No, it is about life and death. People die, and their eternity hangs in the balance of that, whether they know God through his son, Jesus Christ, or not. How do we know that? Because the Bible says so, because the word of God, he's spoken. He has spoken, and he's preserved it for us. And that is why it's so important. And does that make sense? That this is more important than Facebook. This is more important than ESPN. This is more important than anything that we do, because our lives, our children's lives, our grandchildren's lives, the people we encounter with, their lives depend on the word of God and what he's already said. Just as creation depended on his word, the sustaining of all of creation depends on his word, our life and death depend on his word. And that's how important it is. Okay, questions. Trying to look at that, staring at that clock.
When you and Rex said, reminded me of when Christ said he'd never seen greater faith, when the Roman centurion mentioned the hierarchy.
About authority.
The authority.
I'm a man under authority. Yeah. It's an understanding of that. Yeah. The guy understood. You don't have to come to my house.
Just say the word. Yes, sir.
I was just going to throw in James 1:18. It says, of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth. We might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures.
Yeah.
Tell me what you're hearing tonight in understanding the word of God. I mean, that so far all the books we've looked at, and maybe even past that. Do these things make sense? Like, for instance, the mess. Why Joshua? They were told God. What did God say in Genesis, in Deuteronomy 7 and chapter 20? Also,
this is
what I will defeat those nations and I will hand them over to you. And you are to what?
All of them.
Did they do that here? No. So they end up here with this mess. Seven cycles of sin and disobedience, enslavement under a foreign power. They cry out to the Lord, God sends a judge, and then they do it, and they repeat that process all over again. And then the last few chapters, 17 to the end of the book, examples of how man left to himself, there are no boundaries. There are no moral, ethical, legal boundaries. Okay? But he tells us here in the book of Ruth that God's purpose is not, okay, let me say the word, thwarted. They give me a hard time because my Filipino tongue sometimes has trouble with that. God's purpose is not thwarted. Okay, it's not stopped or negated by the sinfulness of man. And by the way, if you ever wonder why Lacan is so negative towards man, because guess what our contribution has been in the redemptive story from Genesis all the way to today? Sin, rebellion. That's our contribution. If not for the grace of God, if not for His Word, and that's why I appeal to y'all, it must be fresh, it must be every day. And what scared me when we were in Rome, because I asked the question, how can Revelation 13 be true? That people will worship Satan and the Antichrist. How do we go from creation to worshiping the very one who was just waiting for God to speak so He can contradict Him, to worshiping Him? And the people that we saw, the masses we saw at the Vatican, and the kind of religion that they practice. And as I saw that, because I was asking in myself those questions, and then the Lord showed me, Lacan only takes for Lacan, not the peoples of the world, to walk away from me. If you do not feed on my word, belong to a fellowship on a regular basis, you don't spend the time nurturing your heart, and you don't submit to the fellowship, the community of believers, if you do not worship, you will walk away from me also. And I'm going, oh my goodness.
Being deceived like she was in the Garden of Eden?
Yeah.
I mean, is it not in our own humanity as easy as that?
But what's worse?
What's worse, Laura, is Adam. Because he knew exactly what he was doing. But see, most of us do not just trip into sin. We may not plan it, but we willfully do it.
Well, I'm thinking of his human nature. If we aren't plugged in, like you were saying.
Keep in mind, though,
Adam did not have that sinful nature. He was perfect. He didn't have Facebook. He didn't have ESPN. He had no devices, nothing. He, in his own mind, in his own heart, chose to disobey God. And the consequences we're still suffering from. Of course, I can't blame him. I just have to look at Lacan. And that's, to me, that should be an encouragement to us to daily, on a regular basis. It's not even a walk with Christ daily. We have to walk with Him moment by moment. That's why Paul says, pray without ceasing. Kenneth Weiss translates that. Pray with the consistency of a hacking cough, he said. And how do you do that? It is that mindset. It is constantly thinking about the things that Christ has been showing us through His Word. That's the only way. Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. What does Romans verse 12, 1 and 2 say?
By the renewing
of your mind, so that you may know God's will, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. How do we know the will of God? Well, you know, I've just been thinking about this, and I just get this sense that this is what God wants me to do. Stand solidly on what God has already said.
Do you ask a theological question then?
Yes, ma'am.
Without going into too much of the New Testament? When Jesus said to His disciples, I will not leave you as orphans, you know, the Helper will come, but in order for the Helper to come, I need to go. That was a pivotal thing for us to mm-hmm. continue forward from that moment, because without the Holy Spirit, we're orphaned.
That's the sense of what He said.
He said, it is better if I go.
Look what every time one of these kings dies.
Yeah.
I don't think we just don't take it into consideration, the weight of it, that we should.
Well, oftentimes we don't, and
I'll tell you why we don't. Because we don't know what the Scripture says oftentimes. And even though we've been at church, I mean, how many of you have really just seen this growing up in the church? Normally you'd say, okay, husbands, you need to treat your wives nicely. You need to come to church, you need to tithe. You know, 10%. I've been a tither, I've been a 10%er for all of my life. And Piper said one time, he said, if you just give 10% to the Lord, you're probably robbing Him. You want to look at the law? About 22.5%, 22 and what is that, 3/4%. But that's not the content of New Testament teaching in terms of that. That was what was required of Israel. What is the requirement for the people of God in 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 8 and 9? We give cheerfully, generously, the what?
Regularly.
Those are the things. It's an attitude of the heart. And if your attitude is right, what is money? I mean, think about it. What is money? What are you going to do with it? I mean, the closer I get to probably the end of my days, the more I'm going, well, what is that for? I know we need it to be able to function. But think about it. Our Father in heaven, does he not own everything? Can we not ask him? Can we not trust him for the things that we need in this life? He already said that. He'll take care of us. But faith although it's the only currency that we have in our relationship with God, it's oftentimes neglected because we try to figure out, like we will see Saul. You know, the guys are leaving. I know I need to do something, so I just went ahead and made the offering, even though I'm not a priest. We tried to figure the what? Yeah, I kept the good stuff for you're raising your hand, Brad? Okay. I want to put one more here. And we will look at it here in a minute, but I just want to go ahead and put it here. The Davidic covenant. And I want you to tell me after we look at it what kind it is. And then the fourth one that we will look at, and at the end of the class, we will hopefully connect all of them. You remember where this is mentioned? Where is the new covenant mentioned in the Old Testament, in the book of Jeremiah, in chapter 31? I used to ask kids that. I said, how many 12 tribes of Israel were there? And one girl told me, said, how are we supposed to know? How are we supposed to know that? Kids are so funny. We're all so funny. Okay, let's. Any questions? I want us to take a break. And
you can collect the cards. Hosea, she wrote them.
Sorry, I'm so bad about that. Okay, let's take a break. Just go ahead and grab something to eat, and we'll resume in 5-6 minutes. I want to mention something else about the overview. The main way that we are imaging God is in our dominion. In Genesis 4, God warns Cain. It says, sin is crouching at your door, and it wants to have dominion over you, using the same word. Sin wants to have dominion over you. And of course, really from Genesis 3, sin has had dominion. Lamech in Genesis 4 also goes even beyond the killing of one man, but it says if Cain, what does he say there?
I don't remember
the exact language. And he's basically saying God's justice is not even sufficient. I will have my own justice. And that's become really the pattern for man. I know what God says, but this is what I'm going to do. This is what I'm going to do. The beauty of this is in the book of Romans, in chapter 6, where Paul says, let me read it to you, to believers, writing to the church. Chapter 6, beginning in verse 11, it says, in the same way, count or reckon yourselves. The word there means to basically to consider and know that it's true. This is not like to just kind of, this is a wishful thinking. Understand this truth about you, basically, was saying. Count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, he says, do not let sin reign, have dominion over you. This is beginning verse 11. Do not let sin reign or have dominion in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Man is supposed to have dominion. Redeemed man is supposed to have dominion over sin. Do not offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer the parts of your body to Him, to Christ, as instruments of righteousness. And then verse 14 says this, for sin shall not be your master, or sin shall no longer have dominion over you, because you are not under the law, but are under grace. So when you read that, you can look back to what God had said from the beginning. Man is to have dominion. Sin is crouching at your door, Genesis 4, and wants to have dominion, wants to rule, wants to have reign in your life. And sin has had a rule until Christ came and destroyed that, the works of Satan and the works of the flesh, and paid for our sins. And also, he says, count yourselves, here's the truth about you, dead to sin and alive to Christ. Therefore, stop offering parts of your bodies. Therefore, stop letting sin reign or have dominion in your life, but offer the parts of your bodies to God as instruments of righteousness, for sin shall no longer be your master. It shall no longer have dominion over you. I love it when you see the language, Old Testament, New Testament, concepts, the same thing.
Yeah,
it's all the same. It's fascinating, isn't it? When you see it in its entirety.
It adds a whole other, I don't know what word I want to use, but it just adds to the context even that much more when you go through Revelation.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody, thank you for bringing up Revelation. Chapter 19, what does it say? When he comes back, second time John sees heaven open, and says, I saw him riding on a white horse coming down from heaven. And how is he described? the King, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, one who has dominion, one who has ruler over everything. And also the language, also in Colossians 1, 15, for he is the image, Christ is the image of the invisible God. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible, invisible, principalities, and describes all of creation. And he's basically saying he has dominion over all of them. When you see that, you're going, oh. And he is in us. And we are supposed to have dominion. It's pretty neat, isn't it, when you see it? Okay. Page 89. 1 Samuel. And this is Israel rejecting God as their king. The easy outline is you have it here on page 89, chapters 1 through 8. Samuel is Israel's last judge, and it's also the first prophet that is mentioned. Chapters 9 through 15 is Saul as Israel's first king. Chapter 16 through 31, David is God's first king. And the material that we have does make the distinction that Saul, even though Saul was picked by God to rule over his people, that it was the choice of the people. It was their decision to seek after a king. And he does, God tells him that, and Samuel tells him that he was the one, that they were the one, when they wanted a king, like the rest of the nations, that they were rejecting the theocracy, the rule of God over their lives. And that's what they were rejecting.
You think that's why he's pictured as, well, he's hiding at the beginning. He's timid and hiding. It's this image of man trying to be in control of reality. When it comes down to it, we can't and hide from it. You think that's any part of it? With Saul?
Oh, Saul. Because I was thinking about Samuel.
No.
He was hiding.
When it comes to him, when they've chosen him as king, they can't find him. He's hiding in the background. And they have to throw him out.
I don't know why he was hiding.
Although he probably can give us a clue from the text and what he said. I am from the least of the tribes. And we know that from the book of Judges, what happened to the tribe of Benjamin. They were almost wiped out. From the least of the tribes and from, what does he say? The least of the clans. And basically saying, I'm insignificant in terms of position in this nation, and I'm being picked as king. And then also there's the description of how is he described in 1 Samuel? Tall, handsome, head.
Reminds me of how
Stacy described Rex when we were in Kenya. Yeah, broad-shouldered, cowboy hat, cowboy boots, tall. And she said with a big smile on her face and an utter delight, she says, and cute.
Well, I wasn't there, was I? So,
so he was that. Of course, when Samuel was picking the replacement for Saul, and Samuel thought, okay, this must be it, one of the brothers. And what did God tell him? Yeah, he looks at the heart, not appearances. And that's a common thing for all of us. But even as we look at that, 1 2 Samuel and the rest of it, keep in mind this theological background, okay? God is carrying out his redemptive plan. The promise of the seed. He made the promise to Abraham in Genesis 12, 1 through 3. He told his people to mediate him to the rest of the nations, because that's always been his heart from Genesis 12, 1 through 3, we'd see that through you, all the nations of the world would be blessed. That has always been the heart of God. It's not just the choosing, the election of the nation of Israel was functional rather than intrinsic in their value. Because he said that to them, I did not choose you because you're more numerous or better than all the rest of the nation. I just simply chose you to accomplish this. And so in that sense, we also have that function. So keep that in mind. God is carrying out his redemptive plan through Israel and in the New Testament through the church. Of course, what Christ, all of that Old Testament pointing to Christ, New Testament, we look back to Christ, and now the church is the embodiment, the body of Christ, the living organism that is the image of Christ. Who are the key people in chapters 1 and 2? What can we say about Hannah and her condition, her circumstances, and also about what can you say from your readings about Eli and his sons?
Going on a limb here, paraphrasing, but Eli what would administer be the right word? Did appropriate properly mm-hmm. what his position was in that and his sons as well.
Okay. He didn't raise his sons.
He didn't. Okay. There was he didn't have dominion. he didn't. Take the position he was given in
approval.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's the same thing that David did later mm-hmm. with his son. It's that same pattern. Mm-hmm. Knowing what should be done and how they should be paid, and yet not, but then again, you know, David carried the guilt of what he had done, so kind of, I'm sure he was kind of like, what have I done? How am I going to forgive it? But, you know, as parents, sometimes it's hard to discipline. Sometimes it's not.
I don't think you ever.
Well, Samuel had
to say. Yeah. Well, that's what I was going to say. It's really a terrifying thing because consistently we've seen this, that the parents may walk with God, but the kids often don't. And it's just a continual pattern throughout Scripture. And
Does that make sense why God said what he said in Deuteronomy 6:4?
And 5. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. It begins with us. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength. And then what are we supposed to do once our walk is fine? Teach this to your children when they rise, everything. Whatever it is they're doing. It's not just catechism is good. Sunday school is good. All of that thing is good. It's important. Those things are important. But just as important is just in the normal course of the day, everything that we go through is a teaching tool for them. Not just about morals and ethics, but keep this in mind. What is the whole Bible about? It's about God. If they can learn about God and what the Bible says about God, they'll learn ethics and morals. Too often in our churches, we do not have a high biblical view of God, because we have reduced the Bible into a book of morals and ethics. But the morals and ethics are only meaningful as they are anchored on the person and the purpose of God, of who he is. They don't simply exist so you and I can get along, or we'll get along. No, because we are, the purpose is that. We are his image.
We have a testimony about doing that faithfully.
A mother teaching
their child day in and day out. Remember Vacation Bible School this summer? And Mr. Liam.
It was the cutest thing we were talking
about. And when we go to bed.
done, Bashan.
No, it's after everybody said.
Okay. That's right. You saw it.
Yes.
And I know this is simple, maybe too simple for a lot of people, maybe too antiquated even. But really, one of the most common things, just an everyday thing which we do anyway, is when we eat a meal together, make that a meaningful time. And I'm not talking about just, okay, I don't want to hear anything from you because I'm going to read from Deuteronomy tonight as we, I don't mean that. But as you talk about life, always point them to the Lord. Always give them, let them see, let them train the kids and the grandchildren in seeing life through the lens of the scriptures of who God is. And that routine of just eating together is so important, being together. Too often we're so busy. What are we busy for? The older I get, the more I'm going,
who God is and the morals will take care of itself, that it just popped in there going back to Kenya, because there's been a lot of, they've told us, there's been all these marriage conferences, they don't do any good. And when you go in and you tell them, okay, you need to do this and you need to do this and you need to treat your wife like this, but when we went in and started with the basis and we started, and this is God's design and this is why He's created marriages, and this, and as lights went off, and it's like all of this stuff on the board here, it's like, oh wow, I see the purpose. Yeah. Then all that other stuff was just easy and fun. Mm-hmm.
If I'm understanding JT correctly, that just confirms a whole issue with regards to everything that we're going through in the New Testament, everything that we see, Deuteronomy, heart condition was a big issue there. But even in today's application, if you have an audience that wants to understand God, that wants to have a relationship with God, their ear will be turned to hearing even the simplest of things spoken at a dinner table. But if a heart really could care less, then is it not the same situation?
Yeah, it is. And
keep this in mind, when we teach Sunday school or whatever we're doing, I know Eric does a lot online. He does videos and he gets actually lots of hits from the Philippines, just evangelistic stuff. But all of those things, I think of Isaiah 40 a lot. It says, those who bring good tidings, raise up your voice and shout. Those of you who proclaim to Judah, he says, climb up on the mountaintops and say with a loud voice. And the message is, he says, here is your God. That's the message. Here is your God. No, most of the times it's not our message. You've got to do this. And I'm not saying don't have practical applications in terms of that, but the practical applications will only come from a healthy, biblical, good understanding of who God is, the way He's described Himself in the Scriptures. We can mess up by ascribing to Him, his traits greater than the others. In American evangelicalism, historically, they've said that the God is the God of love, period. That's why you come up with Rob Bell's Love Wins. Everybody gets saved. Everybody goes to heaven. And that's how you can get messed up, if you simply use your mind instead of using the scriptures to understand who God is. So the message of Isaiah, the message that we have in our Sunday school, whatever lesson we're doing, we want to have that understand. Here is your God. That's the message. Not like we will wow them with all the details and stuff and you're supposed to make them do things. If they see God, how many of us do what the psalmist says in the Psalms, where it says, one thing I asked of the Lord, one thing I require of Him, that I might dwell in His house to do what? To gaze at His beauty. How many of us normally come to church to gaze at God's beauty? A lot of times we'll say, well, I wonder what Lacan is going to be talking about today. I wonder how well, you know, how funny he's going to be or unfunny he's going to be or whether I like the music or not. But when do we stop and just say, I want to come to worship so I can gaze as he opens his word, I can gaze at the beauty of my God. We don't normally do that. But we should, because that's the purpose, is for us to know him. To know him for who he is. Okay? So 1 through 8, chapters 1 through 8 is about Samuel, his birth. That's pretty tough, by the way. You know, we have baby dedications. He was given up. Well, not given up in the sense like he was ignored, because she was still, even after she left him there, what was she doing every year? She would make him, thought about you, Shell, the way you make things. You know, I said, well, he's probably grown this much, and so she'd make him robes to wear. And
the thing that hit me was, you know, it was right after he was weaned, and I thought, well, in a lot of cultures, that weaning age is very different.
Yeah.
You know, but, oh my goodness.
It's pretty young.
Young. They say, I've read commentators, and they say probably around 4 or 5. Even if he's 6. I don't know if I can. That's tough to do. And then one of the key things that it's mentioned there in chapter 3, verse 1. In those days, what?
The word of the Lord was rare. That's a sad thing.
Well, keep in mind where they were. This is the transition from between this period, Judges, which includes Ruth, to the monarchy. And that's how they, you know, they pretty much, the word of God was lost in that Judges chapter 2. And Joshua, who knew the Lord and the things that he did, died. And the elders who knew the Lord and the things that he did, died. Another generation grew up who neither knew or acknowledged the Lord and the things that he did. And so you've got a generation, maybe two generations, who did not really care what God had to say. And this is repeated also during the monarchy, when Josiah found the law, or secretary found the law. They haven't had it, and you know, they haven't done any of the feasts because they didn't have the law. They'd forgotten it. It's easy to forget, even amongst the people of God. Eli, the priest, on page 91. Of course, Hannah was Samuel's mother, and she left him as she had promised, she left him with Eli. And Eli and his sons were just wicked people. By the way, do you remember what the sons were doing? They were sleeping with women at the entrance. And what were they doing with the sacrifices that they were taking before the fat was burned? And that's one day I walked into the hospital room, and this lady hadn't seen me in a while, and I guess I'd gained weight, and she said, Lacan, you look fat. And her adult daughter just couldn't believe her mom said that. I'm so sorry. I said, oh, that's okay, because the scripture says the fat belongs to the Lord. That is why it's supposed to be boiled, burnt up first. That's how I always remember the text. The fat belongs to the Lord. Thank you for saying that. The what? Oh, Kim has a picture of me. Had a picture of me. Once in a while when I, you know, just get excited about food, and she'll pull out that picture and go, okay, I get it. Oh, skinny. But since then, well, I'm still tall today except from side to side. That's from Fiddler on the Roof. Okay. Chapters 9 through 15 is the choosing of Saul. Okay, let's just look at some of the things that he did. I know we talked earlier about he didn't really have a heart for God. How do we know that? Why would you say that he didn't have a heart for God? Saul.
Sacrificed in honor of Samuel for the sacrifice.
Mm-hmm. And what did Samuel tell him?
To be your
about his sacrifice.
To obey is better than sacrifice.
To obey is better than sacrifice. Mm-hmm. Obedience.
Obedience is the sign of our faith. And in the New Testament, the Gospel of John tells us, Jesus says, if you love me, you will obey my commands. We do not love God because as a result of us feeling good towards him, but it is manifested by the obedience that we exercise and manifest in our lives to how he's revealed himself to us. Okay? And then in 16 through 31, I'm just kind of going over this, and I know you all have a lot of details. Hopefully you've been reading the books.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Quick question.
Okay.
Before we move on to David, and you may just tell me that you don't know that it's one of those weird chapters in Scripture, but Saul and the Witch of Endor.
Okay.
Oh, I guess I did them
for him.
Okay.
It's in person.
It's the very end.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, Saul is very, very end. Is that
right before he died? Or before that last battle?
So that's when he's lost his kingdom, and he wanted to find out from Samuel, and he conjures up the spirit of Samuel.
There was all sorts of stuff going on like that.
I mean, you just read that, and you're just like, whoa.
And he actually talks to him.
Mm-hmm. And so when you read the footnotes, and someone say it was Samuel or it was an evil spirit.
And actually, the Witch of Endor, what was her reaction when she saw
him? She freaked
out.
She wasn't expecting him.
Yeah.
She was just like the witches today. She didn't expect that.
Okay, so we just shake your head and go with that one.
It's recorded there, and God allowed him to come back and to tell him basically what was going on. But it was not because the witch conjured up his spirit. Guess who's in charge the whole time? Okay. And keep in mind also, in this might just give us a perspective of that, Numbers 23 and 24, guess who was giving the oracles, the blessings on Israel, who was pronouncing blessings on Israel? It was Balaam, you know, who was a pagan prophet. He was a prophet for hire, and God used him. And, of course, in Isaiah, what have we been studying? The reason that the future generation who are going to be in Babylon would struggle with the word of God was because God says, I will raise up my servant, and he's talking about Cyrus, a Medo-Persian, who was not a believer, because we found manuscripts that he accredited the gods of Babylon and of the Medo-Persians to his victory over Babylon. But can God do that? Yes. And he does it. He's done it. That's why I said yesterday, yes, it does matter who you vote for in the short term. But whoever is elected as president of the United States is not someone that God just says, oh, that's not the one I wanted. No. He's the one who puts that person in office, just as he put President Obama in office, just as he put George W. and Clinton and H.W. and Reagan and all of them. Just as he put Pol Pot and Mao Zedong and Lenin.
With Balaam and this witch, you go into the New Testament and look at
Revelation, look at what all's going to happen there. I mean, it's still all under his sovereignty. It's his authority still at hand.
But that's, by the way...
That's, by the way, repeated, that refrain is... You can kind of see that in during the monarchy. One time later on, and we will look at this next week, who was it? Jehoshaphat was in... He was in the northern kingdom. And he said, hey, before we attack Syria, Damascus, he said, let's ask your prophets. And so... The king, just the Israelite king, brings all these false prophets. And you, I don't know if you remember the question. He said, is there not a prophet of God here? Can we not hear the word of God? And so I don't like what he says. He's always negative towards me. And so, I mean, that's what he's, I mean, you're going, really? But that's how man is. Guess what Saul was doing here?
And actually, all of this, by the way,
Genesis was not given to a blank cultural slate. When he told them this, the book of Genesis, he was giving this to his people who he knew that they will encounter a culture that's very pagan, who worship demons and these false gods, who sacrificed their sons and daughters to the fire, who did all these crazy things. And he's saying to them, why are they doing that? For their provision. And he's already telling them, this is how I'm going to provide. And those people say, what is the case when you look at the cultures of the Canaanite cultures? Why do they believe? I mean, when we were in Rome, we saw all the Greco-Roman gods and goddesses, the rape of what's her name? Bernina. The what? Persephone. The rape of Persephone by Apollo. And what was that about? It's a way for them to gain immortality. Well, God tells them, he said, I will not put up with man, my spirit will not put up with man forever, for his days will be 120 years, for he is but flesh, mortal. He is mortal. You do not gain immortality that way. And so he's saying, you want immortality? 3:15, Genesis 12, 1 and 3. And he goes on, you want immortality? It is only through me, through my way, not man's way. And so the witch of Endor, false prophets, Balaam. I mean, you can go down the list.
Pharaoh's wise men copied the magicians, copied the first plagues.
So, Nebuchadnezzar.
This was actually God working through her. I mean, allowing.
Or in spite of her. Yeah, I mean, but use that time.
Yeah, using her.
Basically, to
let. Yeah, but
you know,
he could have approached, Saul could have approached Samuel. I mean, Samuel, that's what he tried to do. He approached him. But he could have approached the man of God at the time, but he didn't. I mean, is that any different today than what people do? I mean, how many Christians do you know, like, look at their horoscopes or look at the horoscope? And so it's just for fun. Really?
I got big doo-doo. My family will be making a comment about that. Big doo-doo.
And actually on the let's look at on page 92. It says the theme and purpose. The author of 1 Samuel recorded God's faithfulness to his covenant with Israel as God brought blessing for obedience and adversity for disobedience to the nation while it was under the leadership of Saul, who did not have a heart bent towards God. Applicational message, God honors those who honor him. This is only true for the people of God, by the way. Because salvation, keep this in mind, salvation is always just simply by grace. It is simply by grace. And so God honors those who honor him, bringing blessing for obedience and adversity and discipline for disobedience. Of course, this, he already said this in Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy 28, 27 and 28, 28 especially. Let's look at some of your assignment here. What are some, just give, let's just share some of the passages that you picked out and what you put down there as the central truth that is taught in those passages.
Great. He's really proud of his.
I picked chapter 9, 1 and 2. Saul was better looking and taller than the rest of the
But I like that juxtaposition of that, where you go from that to when Samuel is sent to anoint David, and the brothers start walking in and goes, no, not that one. No, not this. Surely this one. He's really tall. And even Samuel still has that in his head. You know, I've got to pick someone that looks kingly. And God says, no, I don't look at that. I look at the heart. You know, so, you know, they got what looked like a king. And it's that part is so funny because he's hiding in the supplies. You know, he's hiding. And they bring him out, and they're so happy. He looks like a king. I'm like, he was hiding.
That's true. That's a good point. By the way, there's a
part here when Samuel told him basically what the king was going to do, and the people finally saw what they did, and they repented, and they said, would you pray for us? And you remember his response. I love his response. Far be it from me to sin against the Lord by not praying for you. You know, it's he considered it a sin to not pray for his people because of the responsibility that he had. And I think about that as the role that we have, I have as a pastor, as a leader, and the role that we have in relationship to our children, to the people that God has entrusted to us. It's more than just something, oh, I got to do that, you know, but we have to do it because that's what God wants from us. And my prayer is that God would give us hearts that see him so that then we run to him. Not so much that we'd say, okay, God, I prayed for my people. But just to understand that really people do not have access to any help. And like I said, and he mentions it here, you know, he's our stone of help. He is our rock of help. Ezer, help. He is our helper, stone of help. And when we realize that, we will run to him. When we realize our utter need for God, we will run to him in prayer. And I just love that heart that he had. Anyone else? What section of that 1 Samuel?
Verse 3:1, God, the word of the Lord was rare. Most people weren't following him. But God is still faithful. God was still working. Mm-hmm. And I like how that shows God's faithfulness.
Yeah. There's a word, and you can
do your homework. Actually, Chad mentioned it last week. There's a Hebrew word, hesed, H-E-S-E-D. And it's an important word. It's you find it in all over the Old Testament. It's actually in Ruth a lot. And it means his faithfulness, his faithful love. Some of the translations will say his loyal love, meaning his the love that he expresses for his people because of the covenant that he made. And so he will be true to that. He will be true to that.
Basically, all of the things he described and none of them never happened.
No.
Oh. But because of God's faithfulness, it's going to happen.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, his word was rare, you're saying that. But the reason he kind of broke the silence was because the people didn't want a king. They wanted a king. And now the people in the rebellion.
Yeah.
Speaks, so it's not a strange
thing. And I know it's in the Bible a lot, where it says, and God says, or God speaks. But think about that God does speak to us. speaks to you. It's amazing. I mean, you try to see Governor Abbott. See if you can get to see him. Yeah. Bless you, my son. Yeah. But you think about that the most important, the sovereign ruler of all creation, the Creator God, he speaks to us and through his word, and he's given us his Holy Spirit who tells us what he's saying, explains it to us. He's given us the body of Christ, the community, so we can process that. Ephesians, by the way, talks about that, so we grow in unity, grow in the knowledge until we reach the full measure of the knowledge of God. And it's done in community, not only in community today, but in community and historically. We look back 2,000 years, 4,000 years, to what people of God have understood, what the Word of God had said, and we benefit from that. And that's why I've said over the years, you know, sometimes we get a little prideful. We say, well, okay, I've got the Bible, I've got the Holy Spirit, leave me alone, and I can figure out what God said. And you can a lot, but he puts us in a community of believers. He's gifted us with teachers, not just today, but in historically, who will allow us to understand what words meant at the time that it was written. That I don't understand those things. I don't understand. I read about Jewish culture, but I don't understand all that stuff. I don't understand. I don't feel the weight of what it meant to them at the time, or what it means to them today. And so we rely on each other, the body of Christ, to do that. So that's, to me, so neat. But God does speak to us. And that just always amazes me, Eric, that he speaks to us. Okay, anyone else?
Well, I had 8 through 11. So when God does speak, he speaks to Samuel. And I thought it was interesting in context that Samuel didn't know the Lord. The Lord's word had not been revealed to him yet. But when he does, the way I put it was, he's changing the order of things. He's changing everything up, because he says that the ears of the people will tingle to what they're about to experience through Samuel.
Eli didn't know what was going on either. Yeah. He hadn't heard from the Lord in a while.
And John and I were talking about how Samuel, there's nothing negative. Except about his kids. But
he learned from the master, from Eli.
But you know, sometimes, and I don't know what the case is, but sometimes you can raise children right, and they're just uninterested. So we don't know if maybe that was
really.
What are you trying to say?
She said that as she turns to.
I'm in chapter 8, verses 4. I just put, you know, when Israel asks for a king, you know, they're denying God's rightful place, his authority. He is king. He is the rightful ruler of that nation. And by denying that, they invite judgment upon themselves.
Today, by the way, to the degree
that we think our future and our security is dependent on the next president of the United States alone, is the degree that we deny the kingship of God over our lives. But if we see him, that he's the one who's in charge, even if the political process and who gets put in the White House, it's okay, you know, because that's how it's. That's who he is. That's what the Bible says. So I know I keep going back to that because I hear that a lot. I have a friend who said, I hope they get it right in South Carolina. I'm so glad that God uses even the mistakes I make and turns it for.
Yeah.
And God is getting it right every single time. And he will bring us to yes, in spite of us.
So the things that he mentions, several things here, the main teachings that you can find here. I just made a note on this, and by the way, any of this just strike a chord in you, any of these main points, main teachings mentioned on pages 93 and 94?
The one really, of course, it played into a lot that went on this last week going into the weekend, but God will sometimes give us what we think we want just to show us what we need. And of course, you can see that laid out, but even in the minute things of our life, that only when I was thinking about that, what hit me was going back into Genesis and thinking about man's heart, and our Creator God is the only one that truly knows the depths of man's heart. Because we would lie to ourselves about the reality of our own heart condition. So that being platform to this was like, wow. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's been...
We have a wonderful God, don't we? by the way, I just made a note here. I'm pretty sure I know what Dennis Mock meant by this, and I made just a couple of notes because it reminded me of a couple of scriptures immediately when I saw it on the middle part on page 94, which says we need to seek and follow God's counsel, not the counsel of men. I think he's probably saying we need to seek God's wisdom and not the wisdom of men, because a couple of places, Proverbs 15:22 says, plans fail for lack of counsel, but with many advisors they succeed. And then in Proverbs 24:16, surely you need guidance to wage war, and victory is won through many advisors. And so, and I think, and also my sensitivity to the mystical movement in the church where they say, oh, I don't need anything. I just, God is telling me what I'm supposed to do. And I've heard people quote even the Gospels, the Lord Jesus Christ, where he said, I don't do anything except what the Father tells me. But then they don't talk about the scriptures. They talk about just basically what they sense. And I'm not saying God can't give you that, but even the sense that we have of what God is saying, the ideas, the thoughts, maybe the dreams we have, they all must be put through the test of the scriptures. Do they fit within the context, within what God has said in his word? Because if they don't, that's probably you doing it. Or somebody else messing with you, the witch of Endor, messing with you. Well, now she's dead, but I'm just saying, make sure that we use the Word of God as the litmus test for whatever it is that we sense, we feel, we think, whatever that may be. Okay, so I know what he's saying. Don't seek man's wisdom, but seek God's wisdom.
Test of the scripture is what you would apply to the counsel of men. Mm-hmm. You know, certainly it's good to receive counsel, but that's the thing. That's the other thing he's saying, is to hold God's standard higher.
And actually, thank you for bringing that up, because
oftentimes when you hear, like, if you need quote unquote counseling, Christian counseling is not a Christian who happens to be a counselor, but counseling that is based, founded on, and it's firmly anchored on biblical truth, on the scriptures. Okay, it's not like I know he goes to whatever church and he's a counselor. I know too many counselors who, quote unquote, church counselors and Christian counselors who don't give you somebody you and I know. Two Christian counselors told her years ago, she and her husband, it's better for you to just start over. Just get a divorce. Start all over. And I just told him, I said, what does the Word of God say about that? So, okay.
Well, that's one of the things. 15, 13 through 28 is where Samuel has to go and kill Saul. Mm-hmm. And I've got down here that we must be faithful. faithful to proclaim God's word, whether it's comforting or not, easy or hard, convenient or inconvenient, costly or not, proclaim his word, all of it. And you know from reading on that it's how much Samuel loved Saul. We assume that Samuel was aggravating Matt, but he wasn't. And so it had to have been very hard to go to Saul and tell him, this is it.
Yeah. It's never easy to confront
anyone, but we should be more afraid of God than of people. And too often, too many things are not done rightly in the church, in our relationships, because we're afraid of people and their reaction and how it makes us feel rather than doing the right thing. And that's why over the years, you know, those of you who have worked closely with me, I'm not saying I was right. I've stood up in the church before and I said, how I handled this was wrong and I need to ask for your forgiveness. I understand that. But we need to do the right thing and let the chips fall where they may. Preach the word in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For a time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine, with healthy doctrine, but instead they will gather unto themselves, heap unto themselves teachers who will simply tickle their ears. And we're there today. We are there today. Okay? Yes, ma'am?
The passage for the chapter 31, verses 1 through 4, Saul's death.
Mm-hmm.
That to me, of course, I didn't state the sentence this way, but that's to me, if you go back through what happened and what Samuel spoke to him about, you know, the Lord's anointing is no longer with you.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
What a culminating end.
By the way, that's the heart that David,
had. I love that. Which some pastors, I've had some pastors abuse that text. When people will bring up some complaints against them, and they will quote what David said, you shall not touch the Lord's anointed. Of course, I'd love to quote, wounds from a friend are faithful, but the enemy multiplies his kisses. We ought to love the Lord and love each other. From that. Okay, how about 2 Samuel? Go ahead.
Go to 2 Samuel. I keep hearing this a lot lately, just this distortion of the relationship of David and Jonathan. It's becoming more and more common that it's portrayed as a homosexual relationship between both those, and we know it's a distortion, but how do you explain culturally? Do you understand culturally the kind of relationship they have? Have you done any kind of studying of that, what that looks like? I know the scripture gives us some insight. I think he says, I was looking at it earlier, I can't remember where it was, but that he loved David as himself. But was that a common thing with the closeness of relationships where even they would share a kiss and whatever that meant?
Well, the kiss was not
like what we would think of a kiss.
Right.
It's a common thing for them to give a kiss. They still, some cultures still do that today. Guys, French do that. You know, men with men, they would. Frederick Forsyth, I love that. I mean, I know this is fiction. The Day of the Jackal. The only reason the jackal missed at the end was he was trying to assassinate De Gaulle, was he forgot the French practice of kissing. And De Gaulle, as he hung the medal on this veteran's neck, he bent down as the jackal pulled the trigger, he bent down to kiss him on both cheeks. So he was loading up, and that's when anyway, you can read the book. The original book by Frederick Forsyth is so much better than the movie that they made with the other things. There's never a picture of the jackal, nothing. It's wonderful.
Good. This will help you at all, but a dear friend of mine married into a Greek family, and I was her maid of honor, and I spent a little over a week in California. And as their family members came to the States and met with other family members that are here in the States, the men showed more emotion toward one another, to the point of grasping one another in tears and holding each other's faces and kissing, like their cheeks, you know, that kind of And even at the wedding, when they danced, the men danced together and the women danced together. And there were only a couple of dances where we were allowed to dance with the men. But it was very emotional, you know, in that culture. And I think, you know, that's still threaded through a lot of the European cultures in that.
But even supracultural,
something that transcends culture, is just a friendship that is just real and solid. And, you know, I don't know who said it. I don't know if the person was a Christian or not. But I think it probably captures that sense of that, of what true friendship is, that close. I wouldn't use the word that, that Chad used about maybe last time.
Do not repeat that.
Yeah, I know. But somebody said this. He said, friendship is one soul in two bodies. And it's just that closeness that two people have. And to me, it's a beautiful relationship, really. So much so that even after Jonathan was gone, and you find David thinking about the promise that he made Jonathan. And so he asked his servants, he said, is there anybody else left in the family of Jonathan? Of course, you could hear Mephibosheth when he was told the king was asking for you, because why would the king ask for a descendant of the heir to the throne? To kill him. And as Swindoll one time portrayed it, he said that it's probably a beautiful sight and sound, because he brought him to his family, restored his land and all of that, his possessions that his grandfather had and his father had. And he says, but every time during meal when Mephibosheth was coming, because remember he was lame, and you could hear the thud of his crutches, which was the sound of grace, he said, coming to the dinner table, sitting at the king's table.
I wonder if that was one that answered why would you treat, you know,
this, oh, yeah, this is a dog like
dead, as a dead dog. It's like, I'm going. You know, you think he's...
I've been found out. I've been hiding all this time. And...
No, someone spilled the beans. I'm here. He's a descendant. I love that, by the way. And to me, that's the closest relationship that they have. It's a beautiful thing. And I know we love to make the beautiful things of God something that's perverted. It's what the enemy does. Sex is beautiful, but the enemy makes it something so ugly. I mean, so much so that there are Christians who were virgins when they were married who struggle with it because of just some wrong notion that the enemy has put in their heads about physical intimacy. But friendship, the kind that Jonathan and David have, that was... If you're watching this and you think that was a homosexual relationship, you need to read the rest of the Bible, and God loves you. But you cannot condone your behavior by excusing what God explicitly said is sin. I mean, so.
I think at the point when I can't find the verse, I'm looking for the verse when Jonathan and David saw each other. Doesn't it describe, if we could find the verse, I think it was of the Lord, because if you look at the way that the Lord used Jonathan in David's life, he protected him. And so as much as the Lord anointed David, he also allowed that. It was probably almost a godless friendship from the start because of the way that they met. But I can't find the verse.
It says, yes, Jonathan was knit to the soul of David.
Yeah.
And Jonathan loved him as himself. It's chapter 18, verse 1.
And that's, see, to me, that's the hand of God.
Yeah. Yes, sir. I've also heard people arguing that, saying, well, David also sinned with Bathsheba, but with that, you have repentance that came. Mm-hmm. And you know.
Wouldn't have been called.
Right. There were consequences, and there was repentance. Type of works, whereas, you know, if that were, you know, it's pretty self-explanatory.
Yeah. Right, because God's not going to contradict himself by taking out Sodom and Gomorrah.
Yeah, and that's to me the beauty
of the Word of God. God does not He's not inconsistent. He's not illogical. He says what he means, and he means what he says. He calls sin, sin, and he does not hide it from us. And it's not, and really when you see sin from the perspective of the gospel, you see it as a God showing you, basically exposing our hearts so that we will see our need for him, our redemption. It is, when we understand our sinfulness in light of the gospel, it is a gracious, merciful act on the part of God. Because he could have simply just left us in our own ignorance and enjoying our sins. But no, he wants to redeem us. And so he tells us that what we're doing is rebellion against him and sin against him. So those statements that the Word of God says, they're for there for clarity for us, not to confuse the issues. So, okay, anything else? We've got a few more minutes, and I want to, in 2 Samuel, we can see David's, of course, he breaks it down into chapters 1 and 10, his rise as the king. And then 11 and 12 is his David's fall. This is when he sinned. And then 13 through 20 is David's, all the problems that he had, family problems, rape of Tamar by his son, murder of Amnon, Absalom's revolt, David's flight, Absalom's defeat and death, David's return to the throne. And by the way, a lot of the Psalms were written when David was in the period between before. David was probably named king when he was a teenager, and he did not ascend to the throne until he was 30 years old. And so a lot of the Psalms were written at the time. There are also a lot of Psalms that were written when his own son Absalom was chasing after him. Psalm 2, 3, 4, 5 were written at the time. Probably 63 is also a Psalm written when he was fleeing from his son Absalom. There's a scary part. When I was an associate pastor here, people would come to me and thank me for what I was doing, and I was so aware of this, what Absalom did. You remember what Absalom did? He sat at the city gates, and as people were coming to bring their problems before the king, he would stop them, and he said, if there's only someone who really cares about you, and then he would listen to them. And remember what it said about him? He stole the people's hearts. It's so easy to do that. And just listening, paying attention to people. And David, by the time, probably he's got his other people. And it's so easy to do that. And that's why at the time when I was associate pastor, when people would come to me, because I was aware of that, God just kind of like, don't do that. Don't steal people's hearts. People say, well, thank you so much for visiting us in the hospital or whatever. I said, if you want to thank me, I said, go next door, because the pastor wanted to be there, but he couldn't be there. And he sent me to, and he did. He sent me to minister to you and your family. And I was so thankful when Gordon resigned, and there were a couple of people who came up to me and said, your problem is you're too loyal to Gordon. I said, well, thank you. Because I didn't want to. I was scared of that passage. He stole the people's hearts. And it's so easy to do. But David, by the way, if you can see all of this, the characters, and people have asked me this with the pastors on Thursday, we were in Acts chapter 12, chapter 12, verse 5. You know, Peter, chapter 12, it says Herod had James arrested and put him to death. And when he saw that the Jews, that this pleased the Jews, he also had Peter arrested, basically for the same reason. He was going to put him to death. Well, Peter just slept through the night. And verse 5 says, but the church was praying earnestly for Peter. And it's easy to say that. And somebody asked last week, he said, how do you parse this? Where verse 5 says they're praying, the church was praying earnestly for Peter. And then when God released Peter, and he knocks on the door, and Rhoda opens the door, and then shuts the gate again on him, and he tells everybody, he said, they were praying, still praying. He says, Peter's out there. He said, you're crazy. And they asked, one guy asked me, so how do you parse that? I said, well, it's from the beginning, man has been inconsistent in his relationship with God. Even godly men like Abraham. What did Abraham do? First sign of trouble. There was famine in Egypt. What did he do? You can't even blame Elimelech and Ruth. for going to Moab. At least it was closer. It's just next door. He just crossed the river, and he was there. They had food there. What did Abraham do? He went to Egypt. Would he not trust? Why did he not trust God? Because man, our propensity is not to trust God. And that's why God keeps repeating over and over, trust me, obey me, trust me. Your trust is manifested by your obedience to me.
Witness of his brothers that Jesus had risen.
Yeah. But then you come to Matthew
28. It says, you know, tell the brothers, it says, I'll meet them in Galilee. And then it says, and many of them still did not believe. Not just Thomas. A bunch of them still did not believe. And today in the church, you know, we can look at those guys. What about today? When you struggle with life, do you really trust God for what he said, who he is? And his plan for your life, and how he's created you, and how he's redeemed you, and his grace that is sufficient for every need that you have, his mercies that are new every morning, that he will provide for your needs, that he will take care of you, that he will bring Romans 8:28, that all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. Those whom he called, he justified. Those whom he justified, he glorified. Those whom he... Anyway, you know what I'm talking about. Do we believe those things? Do we believe that therefore we do not lose heart because our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all? Do we believe those things? Do we believe that those who want to live godly lives will be persecuted? And so Jesus says, blessed are you when men persecute you and speak all kinds of evil against you on account of my name. For that is the way they treated the prophets. You're in good company. Or do we believe that? Or do we say, by golly, I'm an American and I have my rights? The only right that we have is the right to go to hell. But God has given us life and the fullness of that life in Christ. Whether we're in bondage or we're free. Whether we have money or no money. We're okay. With Christ, you have everything. Do we believe those? When you do not do what Christ, when you and I do not do what Christ has told us to do in his word, then that is the extent that we do not believe him. So, it's all of that. Our contribution to this is inconsistency, rebellion, sin. And that is why we need to always thank the Lord for his grace. Apart from that, what do we have to show for? Nothing. David's exploits, 21 through 24. I want to go back to something here, and I know you probably have questions, but I don't want to miss it, and I want you to turn to, because this is the one I was talking about earlier, which is the Davidic covenant, 2 Samuel chapter 7. 2 Samuel chapter 7. And let's just read that, and... because this is so important. We know that the Abrahamic covenant is an unconditional covenant. God says, this is what I'm going to do. It doesn't matter what you do, and it doesn't matter what we do. God is bringing about his redemptive plan. The Mosaic covenant that God made with the nation of Israel, beginning in Exodus 19, is one that was conditional, that they will be able to function as his possession, as his treasured possession, as a kingdom of priests, and as a holy nation, only if they obey the laws and decrees that he gave them. And what they have shown is they were disobedient. And so that's been going on. So let's look at, I can't find 2 Samuel. That's funny. Someone read... beginning in verse 8 through the first part of 11, and I'll stop you.
Chapter 7.
Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture and from following the flock to be ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I will make your name great, like the names of the greatest men of the earth. And I will provide a place for my people Israel, and will plant them so that they can have a home of their own, and no longer be disturbed. Wicked men will not oppress them anymore,
since the time I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies.
Okay. So,
let me stop there because this is the first part of that, and those verses were the promises that God gave were accomplished or were done, were fulfilled when he was still alive, when David was still alive. And so what did he promise David? To make his name great. Does that remind you of another promise?
Abraham.
And by the way, contrast Abraham, the promise of God to Abraham were the building of the Tower of Babel. What did they say? What was the one of the reasons they wanted to create the Tower of Babel? A name for themselves. We will make our names great. God says, if your name is going to be great, I will do it. By the way, that's a propensity that we still have. That's why you find people writing their names, scribbling them on graffiti, even carved on an obscure tree up in the mountains of Colorado. You find somebody's name, you're going, really? And it's just weird, that the desire that we have. And I've said this before, and I've said it, not because it's because I've said it, it's true, but I just think about biblically that probably in all our hearts there's a chip off of the bricks of the Tower of Babel that is lodged in all our hearts. And it's only the grace of God that frees us from that. And if there's any name that's going to be named in our lives, hopefully it's the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That long after they've forgotten our name, that they will remember the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. That will still ring in their hearts and in their lives. So what else? Verse 9 says, I will make your name great. Verse 10.
Okay, and
also, David, you remember where he was first, where he first settled his headquarters? Where was the first headquarters of David? In Hebron, okay? And then when he defeated Ish-bosheth, who was a descendant of Saul, what did he do? He moved it to
Jerusalem,
and actually that became the site of the temple of God, where God was going to meet with his people. And also, what's the last thing that he says in verse 11? Give you rest from all your enemies. By the way, the land and the place that the Lord gave them, this was as close as they got, well, also his and during his reign and Solomon's reign, to what God had prescribed for them, the boundaries of the land in Canaan, the promised land that he was given them. And of course, now today, when you look at that and you look at the map of Israel today, it's it's shrunk considerably. And so we know that final fulfillment of that land is still what we call Palestinian, covenant Palestinian promise. By the word Palestinian was modern. It's not ancient. It was given by the Romans to that real state in that part of the world as a put down on the Jewish people, and it meant land belonging to the Palestinians or to the Philistines, literally. And that's, he's saying, this doesn't belong to you, it belongs to them. And so we've known it as Palestine, but that was a put down against the Jewish people. Okay, and then verses, last part of verse 11, someone read that through 16.
The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. When your days are over and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, who will come from your own body, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. When he does wrong, I will punish him with the rod of men, with floggings inflicted by men. My love will never be taken away from him as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed from before you. Your house and your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever.
Notice the universal terms that he uses
there for the house, the establishment of his house and his kingdom. And the word house and kingdom are used interchangeably, meaning that he's not only talking about a physical structure here, but he's really talking about his lineage. He's talking about the Messiah ultimately fulfilled in Christ. And so that is the promise that he gave them. And he says, I will in verse 12, Well, in verse 11, the Lord himself will establish a house for you. I was looking for one where it's emphasized. When your days are over and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring, your descendants to succeed you, who will come from your own body. And then notice also, he switched from plural to singular in that same text. And I will establish his kingdom. Because ultimately, even though he's talking about the individuals who will follow after him, he's talking ultimately about the Messiah. Yes, sir?
The Bible mentions punishing him, his descendant, for what he does wrong.
Yeah, and this is the moving in and out of the ultimate fulfillment.
Ultimate fulfillment is in the Messiah, but then, of course, before you get to the Messiah, you had the descendants and we will see that next week in the monarchy, and that the ones who followed after David, and then you don't have to go very far. Solomon does the same thing, starts out as a good king and then ends his life in horrible. Yeah, the lineage of them. Yeah. And then it says, notice the words that he uses, forever. I will establish. He's the one to build a house for my name. And of course, we know he's specifically talking about Solomon. And it didn't happen until after Solomon became king and David was gone. And I will establish the throne of his kingdom. It says forever. Of course, it cannot be referring to just Solomon, because the kingdom of Solomon ended. Okay? So it's again, there's a reference to the Messiah. I will be his father and he will be my son, and so on and so forth. And then it says, your house and your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever. And then there in the Psalms, there are a lot of what we call kingly, royal, what's called royal Psalms that refer to these things. But I wanted to point this out. And by the way, these things happen, and not all of them have happened, because Christ will still return as the returning king, as the ruling king, Revelation 19. But I want you to see that the Davidic covenant, there were... There's those two parts, verses. What verses are those? 8 through 11a. These are things that happened or fulfilled. This is 2 Samuel 7. Fulfilled during David's life. And then 11b to 16, after David's life. And what kind of covenant is this? Abrahamic covenant is unconditional. Mosaic covenant is conditional. What kind is this? Unconditional. Okay. And I want to do this because I want to connect it to Jeremiah 31. Jeremiah 31 talks about, I will establish a covenant with the house of Israel. Let me read that. Verse 31. The time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their forefathers when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after the time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. Where was the law written in the Mosaic covenant? The tablets of stones. It says, I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. Does this remind you of scriptures in the New Testament, specifically in the book of Revelation? God will fulfill this, ultimately. Chapter 21, I saw the new Jerusalem coming down of heaven, and the dwelling of God shall be with man. The word dwelling is the word tabernacle. The tabernacle of God shall be with man forever. He will be their God, and they will be his people. The final fulfillment of this. By the way, I know we got to see this when we were in Rome. The Arch of Titus, which is a victory arch, celebrating his victory, the destruction of Jerusalem, the putting down of the what's called the first Jewish revolt, and the destruction of the temple, which basically ended in terms of worship, the way they worship Judaism. And you say, okay, what's the significance of that? That's where God met with his people. And we see that during the time of Solomon, dedication of the temple. This is the place I have chosen where I will be with my, where my people will meet with me. When the temple was destroyed, Christianity, of course, was already here. And Acts chapter 2, what happens? The Holy Spirit comes upon the 120. They proclaim the church was there. And Paul says to the church in Corinth, he said, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. It's no longer a place, but his people. I love it. You can, again, you can trace the presence. That's another thing you can trace, by the way. I don't have time to trace it tonight. You can trace it from the beginning, the presence of God with his people from beginning. And we've seen that in Exodus. How does the book of Exodus end, chapter 40? The glory of the Lord descended, and they couldn't even enter it. When the dedication, at the dedication of the temple, guess what happens? The priests couldn't go in there because the glory of the Lord filled that thing. Ezekiel chapter 10, I saw the glory of the Lord depart from the temple. Ezekiel chapter 4, what is that, 43, talking about the millennial kingdom, saw the glory of God coming back through the eastern gate, the same way that it left. I mean, you can trace that all throughout the scriptures. It is fascinating. And I've said this before, but the Muslims knew when they controlled Jerusalem that prophecy about the return of Ezekiel 43, that they bricked the eastern gate. Oh. But we do stupid things, don't we? I can't even look at the Muslims. Okay, so you could see, and this is, well, okay, what kind is this? You could see when you look at all of the scriptures and through these four covenants that God is working to accomplish his redemptive purpose. For his people in the Mosaic Covenant, he says, I want for you to be able to fully perform the function for which I have elected you and I have chosen you, which is for you to mediate me to the rest of the world. You have to obey my laws and my commands. But they failed in that. And, of course, you see the connection with the Davidic covenant and then the new covenant. Ezekiel 36, I'll remove your hearts of stones and I will give you hearts of flesh. And I will write my laws and my decrees in your hearts and I will cause you to obey my laws and my decrees. That is why we say all the time, it makes no biblical sense when someone says, I'm a believer and there's no fruit of Christ living in them. So does this kind of paint, including 1 and 2 Samuel, hopefully a clearer picture, just kind of threading them together, connecting the theological dots? Okay, we have 16 minutes, so questions, comments. Where do I begin? Go on, JT.
Ask a question, go sing again.
It's fascinating, isn't it? It's amazing to see it. He's picked it up. No.
Yeah, love story. I was going to say Alfie, but no, that's a different
story. Pull your band card.
Oh.
Questions or comments?
Questions or comments? I mean, I may not know the answer, but you can ask the question. But we can talk about it.
Well, I mean, talking about this, so I think it's good to bring up that I was fascinated with the story of the men in 23.
Might have been a ballad.
Yeah, the 3 and the 30 and that part where the 3 go down to get the water from the well in Bethlehem to bring it back to David, and he pours it out. And from our own Western concepts, our own Western ideas, it's like, you mean I just wasted that time going down there? But like you pointed out to me that it was he was making an offering to the Lord. He was honoring what they had done. And
you don't get that from tap water.
Yeah.
Something special. Yeah.
But it's a reminder that we have to read the scripture with understanding what the culture is and what's going on at the time and how, and it was. I mean, and if you read that passage in context, what an incredible story. I was telling you, I had posted that and I had people just said, man, these names are really hard. And I said, forget the names. It's not, call them Bill if you want to. You don't have to call them Ben and I, but just think about the story of these people that fought and that was a really neat moment where he said, man, I just love it, drink the water. So they break through and they do, and he says, I can't drink this. And so he pours it out like an offering to the Lord.
Let me ask you this question.
How does getting a glimpse of the theological umbrella over all of these books, over all the Old Testament, affect the way we think and maybe how we might approach books of the Bible that we're teaching or we're reading?
Hones in on the whole knowing that it's all streamlined together in the meta-narrative as God's plan, rather than going into each individual book with, okay, what am I supposed to do with this? What am I supposed to do with this? What am I, it puts it on a whole different level, and I'll testify to the fact that from looking at it since we've started this, from, and this is also backed up with studies in our Sunday school class, that looking at it from the perspective of God's plan versus how is man supposed to fit into salvation and fit into this, there's been a lot more work and conviction in our lives on a personal level. A lot more. Because when you start changing your mindset to focusing on the sovereignty of God, the very breath we breathe, the very elements of our life, it's a whole different subject matter, really.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like looking at the color blue differently, or the color red differently. It's that simple, yet it's
that profound.
Well, yes. I think it's not even looking at it differently, it's seeing it clearly,
yes,
the way that it was intended to be seen.
Right.
Like you were colorblind, but then
you
could see color for
whatever. I have this picture of like a shadowy room, and you have a light on and you're seeing details and stuff, but when you have something like this, you have a brighter light to look through and to see more detail and to see more landscape of what's around you, and it just opens up a whole other level.
Well, it takes all of the study that we did in Colossians last book. Now tie all that into this.
Yeah. Well, yeah, there's a lot to be tied to.
Well, and all of that to Peter. And I mean, it's just...
I just say my prayer.
My prayer, and I'm excited for all of us just to, as we open the Word of God, no matter where it is, for us to discover more and more of that. You can go, oh, wow, we read that. That's part of this. We saw that. That's in Genesis. That's in Deuteronomy. That's in this book. That's in the book of Revelation, because they're all connected. It's one book. It's just one story. Yes, ma'am.
I was going to say, so when you look at it that way, then what we tend to think of as individual books in there just become chapters.
Yes. And so then it doesn't make any sense if you pull a chapter out, or if you can't read a chapter in the middle of the book and go, oh, I know the whole story.
Yeah.
But we wouldn't do that with a regular book, but that's the tendency we have with Scripture, is to pull it out and say, well, I've read this chapter, so now, you know, none of it's interrelated, it's just this chapter.
Yeah. And that's why also it's poverty of soul to feed simply on one verse at a day. Just simply say, oh, it's the verse. Because it's the story of God. It's God that we fall in love with. It's not, we don't use it like a bumper sticker thing, you know. Well, that's a cute saying. No, he's a good God. He's a
God. He's a sovereign God. And the only way to see that is not through cute sayings that we find.
Well, and the human element of taking out our own personal opinions then also on this. Because when you are faced with answering questions of other people in a possibly a platform of testimony or witnessing, it's about God and not about you.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
That's how we went to and we heard about all these issues that they were having, and we were like, about this. But it didn't matter.
Stop it. By the way, those of you who don't know, I don't know if we've told you this, but one of the practices amongst the
Pokot people is the men and the women, number one, they sleep in separate beds. And if the man wants to have physical intimacy with his wife, he has a stick and he just taps on her bed. And she dutifully... She would dutifully come over. So, yeah, there are those issues that, and when we told them what the scriptures say, and I mean, people are looking at it, they're reading their Bibles, smiling and shaking their heads like, I can't believe that's in the Bible. It's hilarious to watch people's reaction. No, that's true. That's true.
Anyway.
Okay, sorry.
Sorry.
It didn't matter about their issues. I mean, we have cultural issues here too that we have to know. We had to be with God's word. Everything, no matter when they would come up and say, but according to our culture, we were like, but what does God's word say?
I find that to be the largest challenge when it comes to witnessing or speaking about, you know, people even approach you and want to have a conversation with you with regards to Scripture in general. You have to first, in some cases, I think, establish whether or not they even look at God as sovereign God and want to take what is written as his sovereign word. Because if they don't, then you don't have a common standing to even have a conversation about, because they're not, it's not even, and I find that to be a big struggle right now.
One thing though is we can trust what he's already said, like Hebrews 4:12, that the word of God is sharper than any double-edged sword and is able to penetrate.
Yes.
Or what Isaiah said, that my word will not return to me void until it accomplishes the purpose for which I sent it forth. Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel because the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. And so we love that we can trust the word of God, that the Holy Spirit can take...
The life is in the word.
Yeah, what the Holy Spirit can take what we may have said, and they may act it even, like, or rejected it at that moment. You and I would part ways with them, but the Holy Spirit will not part ways with them.
I always look at it as seed planted, but it's grieving.
It's also we can trust the Holy Spirit to do His work in their lives. He'll bug them to death.
Yes.
I mean, really. That's something that we can trust the Word of God to do its work. We can trust the Holy Spirit of God to come. We already are seeing it here as we study the Scriptures.
He's carrying out His redemptive plan no matter how man is. No matter what man has done, no matter what man does. And we will even see Revelation 13, that they will worship Satan and the Antichrist. But there's still people who will be saved in those days. And it's 2 Peter. God is not slow in keeping his promises, some consider slowness, but he is patient with us, not wanting anyone to perish, but for everyone to come to repentance. And it's his desire. He loves people. He wants people to come to know him better than you and I would ever desire for anyone to come to know Christ. So we just are happy proclaimers. Yeah, I know. Is that thunder? Oh, any other question? That's a good word, by the way, in the Bible. You can look it up, thunder. Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
How would you describe when David is called a man after God's own heart? I had to look, it was back in chapter 13. How would you describe that characteristic?
Again,
Genesis 6:5, every intent in the heart of man is nothing but evil and wicked all the time. Romans 3, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. No one seeks God. Saul, when he was confronted with his sin, he said, well, I was trying to save the very best for you, for God, and you know, you didn't come and all of that. When David was confronted with his sin, is it only against you, God, have I sinned? Yeah. And to me, I think it's not a heart of perfection, but it's a heart of recognizing God in our relationship with him and a heart of brokenness. By the way, that's an interesting thing. I read an article, actually posted it on our Facebook page yesterday, the day before, about 2 Samuel, about David and Bathsheba. It's interesting when you read Song of Solomon, and we did. I lingered on chapter 4, and then I'll point out chapter 7, years after they have been married, the tenderness, the gentleness, the joy, the pleasure of the physical, the sexual intimacy between a husband and a wife. But the verbs that are used in David and Bathsheba, he sent for her, she came, he laid with her. She left, she sent message, she had, and it doesn't even mention her name anymore. It's just the woman, just calls her, she has a name. But that's how it is. It becomes almost like there's no tenderness, there's no gentleness, there's nothing. It's just, but to me, that's the difference, the distinction I would make between the two. I mean,
well, I guess really, David's one of the few people I think you can really see throughout the scripture having a relationship, and even really having a relationship with God.
Yeah, and you see that in the Psalms, and I love the honesty of the Psalms, because the Psalms
just expresses and records for us what he was going through emotionally and the struggles that he had in life, hardships in life. But he always, it's funny, it's not funny, it's interesting that whatever it's going through in his life, Psalm chapter 3 says many of them are saying that, you know, no one can take care of you. No one is going to save you from your enemies. But it says, but you are my God, the lifter of my head. You know, that's how the position that we have, the posture we have when we feel down, we kind of, our shoulders are hunched, our heads are down. Rain. And it says, but you are the lifter of my head. And then it says, at night I lay my head down, and I go to sleep because you sustain me. But you see also in 5, what he was, it says in the morning, it says, and it's the same scenario. He was fleeing from his son. It says, in the morning, I lift up my prayers to you and wait for you to answer them. But the language, Peterson captures the sense of the language better in the message when he said, in the morning, I lay the pieces of my life in your altar and wait for your fire to descend. He was willing to do that. He was not perfect, but he wanted to do that. He said, here are the pieces of my life. Here's my heart. Here's my mind. Here's what all my actions. And I just lay it before you and wait for your fire to consume them as a burnt offering. Which is, by the way, the language, Leviticus 1, Romans 12, 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. That is the picture of the burnt offering is the only offering where the whole being is burnt. But here he says, present your bodies, your whole body, as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. I love the Psalms. I read them all the time, every day. Because to me, they're such an expression of the struggles that we go through. How almost my feet almost slip when I consider the ways of the wicked, Psalm 73, David wrote. And said, and you know, they don't have any problems, you know, they prosper. And says, until I entered your sanctuary, then I understood their destiny. The word of God. So, okay, it's raining. So let's thank the Lord for the rain. Miss Connie, would you thank the Lord for our time, for the rain, all his goodness to us?
Father, we are just in awe of the continual provision and love that you've shown for David, for your people Israel, for us as your sons and daughters. And Father, thank you for the word that you've given us so that we can come to even closer knowledge of your character and that we can even better image the love that you have for all mankind. Father, thank you for the blessing of rain tonight. Give us safety as we get home, and Father, bring us back again with a good study week so that we can come to know you even better next week. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.